Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.
A ship is safe in the harbor, but that is not what ships are built for. No risk, no gain. Risk and growth are two sides of the same coin. So how do you balance this? So let me ask the man who underwrites risk. Meet Bhargav Dasgupta, MD and CEO of ICICI Lombard. Bhargav, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ravi.
Bhargav, it may sound cliche, but the fact is the world has become a global village. So much so people and business are interdependent and interconnected. An ISIS attack in Paris, a Boko Haram in Nigeria, or flood in Chennai are disrupting supply chains, disrupting economies and businesses. So how do you manage risk in a globalized world?
Look, Ravi, undoubtedly the world is becoming more complex and more volatile. So the socio-political risk that you're talking about is clearly increasing as we speak today. Add to what, apart from the things that you talked about, add to the risk of technology disruption. Not the sort of things that we would cover in insurance, but it's a real issue from business perspective. Finally, the impact of climate change.
Yeah.
Again, very, very visible. You talked about Chennai floods, for
Chennai
example.
Chennai flood, and China also that sense.
Yeah, I'll give you an example. If you remember 2011 Thai floods, from the insurance industry perspective, Thailand was never seen to be a high catastrophe risk market. You hadn't had these kind of events in Thailand for years.
Yeah, correct.
Now, when it happened, not only did it create huge damage to the industry there, but it adversely affected the entire global supply chains for automobile industries.
Yeah.
So you had situations here where some of the manufacturers could not ship out their automobiles. So the world is clearly much more integrated. I think as we look at where the world is headed, one of the realizations that we have is that risk management is now becoming a very important strategic tool. It is not just something that a risk management team in one corner of the organization can focus on.
No more pumping exercise.
It cannot be. It has to be something that the board takes responsibility for. The CEO becomes responsible for. And if you want to build an organization over a long-term period and create long-term value, you have to look at risk management as a strategic tool. The other thing that we are trying to do in the insurance industry is that, when you analyze all the risks that companies face, not all of these risks are insurable. I mean, there has to be alternate solutions, but wherever there are insurance solutions, at least what we are trying to do as an organization is to partner with our consumers, customers, where we are providing them not only risk transfer solutions, which is what we normally do, but also analyzing these risks, identifying, quantifying, and even working with them to mitigate these risks, so that it's more a risk management solution approach rather than just looking at transfer risk from one entity to the other.
Yeah. Ironically, when you look at all the risks that has happened, it negates the very concept of just-in-time manufacturing or outsourcing model. And that is where the modern-day businesses are built out. So how do you beat this? For example, I was told Chennai flood, the insurance sector in the country took a beating of some 2,000 crore. It's an economic loss of something like 15,000 crore. So is there any way corporates can plan for this kind of natural or man-made disaster? How does the insurance company look at this?
Look, just to give you a more recent update on the numbers, the insurance loss we expect will be close to 5,000 crores. As of now, it's between 4,000 to 5,000 crores. We expect around 5,000 crore number. And if you look at typically what happens in terms of economic damage, usually in India, the number is roughly about 10 times that number. In Chennai, the number will be a bit less, but typically
5,000 is 10 times, 50,000.
Yeah, in Chennai, it will be less because the insurable interest in Chennai, the penetration of insurance is relatively higher than some of the earlier events. But, this is not a one-off. As we speak, while we talk about the Chennai floods, there's been very devastating floods in UK. The floods, Eva, it's kind of destroyed more than 10,000 homes in UK, not getting as much media coverage in India as it probably should. If you look at what's happened in terms of the polar temperatures right now, the temperatures at freezing point. I mean, you know, what you would expect in North America at this point in time. Apparently about 15 degree more than what the normal average is.
Yeah.
So the climate change and the impact of climate change, I think, is a real issue that we need to factor into our business.
Okay.
At the same time, coming back to your point, in this world, in this competitive world, you cannot build a business model which does not build in the models of the business as we talked about.
Yeah.
JIT is the way of life. You cannot avoid it. So I think one of the things that organizations need to do a bit better is to do a much better job of scenario planning, stress testing, and business continuity plans. Just to give you an example on Chennai, since you talked about Chennai, what we find is while most of these companies have bought insurance, the extent of insurance that they've bought is inadequate for the size of the calamity that they've faced.
But they must have never expected in Chennai a flood like in last 100 years?
Exactly. The point I'm making is that it's time for us to expect these things to happen.
Okay.
And plan accordingly. And one of the things that people don't buy adequately in India is you buy insurance for the damage, but you at times don't buy enough for the business interruption that happens because of an event. So, for example, when let's say your factory is flooded.
So it could
while
be
you've done enough protection measures for your
plant and machinery,
for your plant and machinery, but you have an issue of access. Your employees are not able to come to your office, and hence the plant is shut. Effectively, there's a huge revenue loss for you. Do you buy adequate cover to protect yourself against those kind of losses? So I think
it's not down to the corporates up to now, this kind of situation where operations also come to a standstill.
Exactly.
So they need to take a insurance for that also.
Exactly.
Okay, Bhargav, I want to draw your attention to the market volatility. It's a reality. Oil prices have fallen from say $110 to some around $30 now. Rupee is getting weaker. Chinese yuan is getting weaker. Euro is getting weaker. Dollar is getting stronger. This is like a moving goalpost kind of environment for CEO as well as CRO. So how do you survive and thrive in such kind of scenario? Risk is given now.
Yeah, Ravi, corporates have been hedging their currency risk and commodity risk over the years. It's nothing new. I think what's happening today is probably a very deep and very high impact event in terms of the extent of volatility that we are seeing, the extent of price correction that we are seeing. But in insurance, there are two things that we do. One is look at the insurance angle, where we provide insurance cover to our clients. The other thing that we do is investment, because we have a pool of money and we invest that money in corporates. Now, from the investment perspective, one of the things that we have to study is some of these global macro trends. Now, over the last 3 years, there have been enough very, very respected analysts who've been waving the red flag, particularly the China risk, on the fact that the commodity super cycle is coming to an end. Now, you may not have predicted that oil will go to 35 when it was at 140.
Now, they're also talking about $20 now.
Yeah, now they're talking about $20. Yeah. But you definitely could have done some amount of scenario planning in terms of oil coming down significantly lower than what it was.
Okay.
Personally, I find that at times, Indian corporate mindset is unbridled optimism when the times are good and deep pessimism when the times are bad.
And extreme oscillation.
Extreme oscillation. In fact, our view is it should be the opposite. When the times are good, you should worry about what could go wrong and do your scenario planning, and vice versa. And there are, mitigating solutions for some of these. There are clearly some amount of business planning risks that you have to look at and manage when you're looking at this kind of volatility in the world.
Volatility risk is one issue. The other big thing that is happening of recent time is reputation risk. It's a risk today some of the corporates are facing. Earlier we saw Coke, Cadbury's, and recent time we saw Maggie. Maggie's reputation risk, for whatever reason, it took a dent both for the reputation as well as the top line and bottom line. So how do you deal with this kind of situations? As an insurance company, what kind of advice you will give them?
So this is a very tricky aspect. And if you look at it, most societies are getting very, very conscious about consumer protection. And companies which are consumer brands are also getting very sensitive over this issue. Globally, there are insurance solutions to this. But insurance solution is a curative solution.
Okay.
So you have reputation, you know, risk, you know, liability solutions where you pay for, let's say, some of the reputation damage that you have, as also you pay for the cost of litigation and things like that. But I think reputation is much more important to look at from a preventive perspective rather than just a curative perspective.
True.
And in terms of preventive practices, at least what we see, you know, globally companies do, insurance companies actually work with clients. It's not very popular in India, but globally insurance companies work with clients, not only providing the curative solution, but also having crisis management teams, experts who work with clients whenever there is a reputation issue that flares up. But I think the most important element for companies to think about is again to build a framework around reputation risk and look at identifying the risk, the source of this risk, look at how do you react to a situation that crops up, how fast do you react. I think that's a critical learning everywhere. You have to be out there very, very fast, and also look at some of the mitigation measures thereafter. And I think what comes through very clearly now is that you have to be as transparent and as honest as possible with your clients, with the society at large, if you want to build a good reputation over a long term.
So this brings me to the pesky issue of social media. Okay, a company runs all kinds of risk. Here it could be a reputation risk, or there could be a run on the bank also. So how do you deal with this new menace, and what kind of advice would you give your clients?
Look, it's, I think all of us are learning. Social media is something which is kind of changing the entire way that organizations have to communicate with customers, you know, consumers and society at large. And I think all of us are learning. At least what we try to do is, again, to have, we build a scenario framework in terms of how we react to social media events. So there is very active monitoring that we have, a team which monitors the social media chatter that is going on. We have a team which responds to any consumers who raise anything in the social media. And I think what is most important learning out of that is the speed and the tonality of the response. The response cannot be very canned, very corporate sounding. It has to be very personalized.
Personal, okay.
And it has to talk, you know, the communication has to be person to person rather than a organization to a person. And one of the elements of being able to do that is you have to have your own organization structure in a manner where information flow goes up very, very fast. Because if something happens in one corner of the country, the team which is handling the social media response has to be fed with the right information to react fast enough.
Okay, Bhargav, the other thing I want to brought up, according to Fikki Pinkerton survey for last 3 years, there are at least four key risks that affect corporate India. One is corruption, bribery and corporate frauds. Two is political and governance instability. Three is crimes, corporate frauds and scams. And fourth is information and cyber insecurity. And interestingly, 11th and 12th are natural disaster and fire. So the risk here is given, and yet companies and sector have taken to have taken a beating. What is the reason for this?
You know, at least what we find is companies are not as conscious of high severity, low frequency events. What I mean by that is things that don't happen every day, but when it happens, it has a serious impact on your P&L or your even your balance sheet. And that's, I think, probably a human mindset. But coming back to the point that you made, I think some of the risks that you talked about are largely related to the context where we work in India, as also maybe governance standards in some of the organizations. And that's something that is probably a board issue, and boards need to fix that. From a insurance industry perspective, an industry which actually protects companies from these risks, I mean, there are certain risks, as I said, we cannot protect. I mean, you cannot protect, you know, governance issues or malpractices.
True.
What you can do is the 11th and 12th, as also the cyber risk. I mean, those are things that happen beyond the control of the management. And that's where we step in and provide solutions to our clients.
We all know digital revolution is here to stay, but so are cyber crimes like hacking, phishing. Are companies investing enough in cyber security? Now, let me read what KPMG said. As per KPMG's cyber crime survey report, 72% of Indian companies faced a cyber attack. Even though cyber crime is becoming a major threat, only 2% of organizations spend more than 20% of the IT budget on information security and cyber defenses. As somebody who underwrites risk, what would be your advice to companies who are cutting corners?
You're absolutely right. I mean, this is something that you cannot cut corners. It's too risky in today's day and age. I mean, if you just remember very recent example of Sony being attacked last year, 2014, end of 2014, it created huge financial as also reputational damage. I think there is a mindset among some of the Indian organizations that it won't happen to me. Where we see sensitivity is we see sensitivity in financial services. We see
BFSI.
Yeah. We see some of the IT companies being very sensitive about
maybe MNCs also.
And MNCs also, you know, sensitive. But what if you look at, let's say, the global market? Cyber liability is the fastest growing segment of insurance globally.
Globally.
And that's obviously because of the underlying risk that we talked about. And if you look at, let's say, the US market, the number one buyer of insurance or cyber liability cover is the retail segment,
in USA.
Not the BFSI.
Oh.
You know, second biggest buyer of you know, cyber liability is healthcare. Now, why do they buy these covers?
Why is healthcare, I was wondering?
You know, let's understand, you know, there is a huge amount of customer data that each of these organizations have. And if a hacker can get access to that information, it is extremely valuable.
Okay.
From their perspective, and it's equally extremely damaging from the client's perspective. Healthcare, because you have personal, you know, data about your patients. So BFSI actually comes third in the US market in terms of buyer of cyber liability cover. Here, these two segments haven't really woken up to the cyber risk as yet. But interestingly, what we are seeing in the last, I would say about a year, year and a half, we are seeing clearly a lot of interest in cyber cover, starting with, as I said, BFSI and IT. But we are increasingly seeing a lot of consumer-driven companies becoming aware of cyber cover.
Bhargav, do you agree that volatility and uncertainty in the market have brought greater focus to risk management as a function, which is viewed more positively post Lehman Brothers crisis?
Everyone talks about the VUCA wars, right, Ravi? I think my sense is that post the Lehman crisis, the global financial industry became much more sensitive to risk. The regulators became much more careful about some of these issues, and in fact they stepped in with a lot of focus on better capitalization, better risk management practices, better governance practices. So I think from a BFSI perspective, the answer to your question is yes.
Yes, okay.
Do I see that translated into other sectors, particularly in the Indian market? I wouldn't say so. I think, you know, again, this goes back to our Indian mindset, as I keep calling it. I think we tend to think that bad things may not happen to me, it may happen to someone else. And I think the mindset of most organizations we find, particularly the good times, is that they think the good times will continue and vice versa. So that's something that is probably changing a bit. Most companies are becoming gradually more sensitive to risk. But it wasn't, I think, driven so much by 2008, but it's driven by personal experiences in their own businesses that they face. And then they realize that they need to protect some of, you know, their organization, their businesses from some of these risks.
But the final question, there are external risks and internal risks. So how do you keep the organization, as they say in Boy Scout, ready for all eventualities? What is the advice you would give the companies?
I really don't know if you can, you know, keep the organization ready for all eventualities. But what I would definitely reiterate is that today risk management needs to be looked at as a strategic differentiator. It's a strategic tool for long-term value creation. And specifically from an insurance industry perspective, we hope that clients understand that this needs to be looked at not just something that you look at as a cost, but needs to be looked at as a tool to protect your organization from damages that could seriously create financial trouble for you. And hence you need to work with insurance industry as a partner to look at how do you reduce the risk.
Okay.
You know, and once you reduce the risk, mitigate the risk, and overall bring more stability to your world, the world which is becoming more volatile.
Okay, the company should look is as an investment, not as a cost.
Absolutely.
Okay, very well put, Bhargav. Thanks for being on the show. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Okay.
Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.